ओम नमः शिवाय स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद क्लास 11 पॉलिटिकल साइंस चैप्टर 4 पार्ट 5 द एग्जीक्यूटिव। इन द प्रीवियस सेशन वी हैड अ डिस्कशन अबाउट द पावर्स एंड फंक्शंस ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट। इन दिस सेशन वी विल हैव अ डिस्कशन अबाउट द डिस्क्रिशनरी पावर ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट। दिस विल बी फॉलोड विद द असाइनमेंट to be done related to chapter 4 part 5 discretionary powers of the president. Before we start with this, let us understand what does the term discretion means. Discretionary or the term discretion means the power to decide or act on its own. So, discretionary powers of the president, let us deal with this. On the basis of the above discussion that we had earlier, we can infer that the president has no discretionary power under any circumstances. This means that the president does not have any power in the administration of the country. This is what has been understood with the previous discussion. Now, this will be an incorrect assessment if we say like this. Constitutionally, the president has a right to be informed of all important matters and deliberations of the Council of Ministers. That means, for the working of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers, the president is informed about all matters and deliberations. Now, the Prime Minister is obliged to furnish all the information that the president may call for. If the president want to ask for the working of the question, working of the prime minister, he or she can furnish all those informations. The president often writes to the prime minister and expresses his views on matters confronting the country and its defense. Now, beside this, there are at least three situations where the president can exercise the power using his or her own discretion. That means, besides the power that we have discussed earlier about the president can also exercise the power using his or her own discretion or judgment. In the first place, if we discuss, we have already noted that the president can send back the advice given by the Council of Ministers and ask the council to reconsider the discussion. This means the president acts on his own discretion. When the president thinks that the advice has certain flaws or legal lacunae, or that it is not in the best interest of the country. So, when the president asks for the advice to the prime minister, and if he or she thinks that the advice is not serving to the best interest of the country, the president can ask the council to reconsider the decision. Although the council can still send back the same advice and the president would then be bound by that advice. Such a request by the president to reconsider the decision would naturally carry a lot of weight. So this is one of the way in which the president can act in his own discretion. So, this is the first discretionary power of the government in which the president can resend the advice or the act or the bill to the president, to the prime minister and the council of ministers for reconsideration. Now, secondly, the president also has certain veto powers. What is veto power? Veto power rests with the president, according to which the president, utilizing which the president can say direct yes or no to a decision. Using the veto power, the president can withhold or refuse to give assent to bills other than the money bill. That means we have read about the types of bill. Three types of bills are there. So other than the money bills, the president can refuse to give assent to the bills passed by the parliament. Every bill passed by the parliament goes to the president for his assent before it becomes a law. So here the president exercises his signatory authority to give consent for the passing of the bill becoming an act. So if the president thinks that the bill has to be reconsulted before it becomes a law and it is not according to the constitutional provision, he or she has all the right to send it back to the parliament for rediscussion. The president can send the bill back to the parliament asking it to reconsider the bill. This veto power is limited because if the parliament passes the same bill again and sends it back to the president, then the president has to give assent to that bill. That means for the second time, if the bill is sent for approval to the president, president cannot reject it. He has to give the consent to the bill and further pass it to the judiciary. However, there is no mention in the constitution about the time limit within which the president can or must send the bill back for reconsideration. This means that the president can just keep the bill pending with him without any time limit. So this gives the president an informal power to use the veto in a very effective manner. So this is sometimes referred to as the pocket veto. So this is the second description where the president exercises his authority. Though limited, it is effective for the president to utilize his powers. Now, this passage which we have read here, the second reason or the second description of the president is important to answer few questions that has been addressed here in the assignment session. You have to go through this in detail or carefully read this and answer the question that has been given here. Now, we saw that there is no time limit on the president for giving his assent to a bill. Do you know that such a thing has already happened? In 1986, the parliament passed a bill known as Indian Post Office Amendment Bill. This was widely criticized by many for its sought to curtail the freedom of the press. Then the president Gyani Jail Singh did not take any decision on this bill. After his term was over, the next president Venkat Raman sent the bill finally back to the parliament for reconsideration. By that time, the government that brought the bill before the parliament had changed and a new government was elected in 1989. This government belonged to a different coalition. What is coalition? Coalition is the alliance made by the political parties or its members to gain the majority and form the government, and did not bring the bill back before the parliament. Thus, Jail Singh's decision to postpone giving assent to the bill effectively meant that the bill could never become a law. So this is about the discretionary power of the president, which is effective for the making of law. Now let us move to the third discretion or the power utilized by the President of India. Now, the third kind of discretion arises more out of political circumstances. Formally, the President appoints the Prime Minister. Normally, in the parliamentary system, a leader who has the support of the majority in the Lok Sabha would be appointed as the Prime Minister. And the question of discretion would not arise. That means the party or the leader who has secured the majority vote in the general election is invited by the president to form the government. So there is no discretion that would arise on part of the president to utilize his power in the appointment of the prime minister. But imagine a situation when after an election, no leader has a clear majority in the Lok Sabha. Imagine further that after attempts to forge alliances, two or three leaders are claiming that they have the support of the majority in the house. That means in arriving to the coalition government also, the purpose is not fulfilled. Now the president has to decide whom to appoint as the prime minister. In such a situation, the president has to use his own discretion in judging who really may have the support of the majority or who can actually form and run the government out of the three. Now, since 1989, major political changes have considerably increased the importance of the presidential office. We have just now read about Gyani Jal Singh's exercise of the veto power, which kept the bill pending and have restricted it to be accepted as a law. So in the four parliamentary elections held from 1989 to 1998, no single party or coalition attained a majority in the Lok Sabha. Now, these situations demanded presidential intervention either in order to constitute a government or to grant request for dissolution of Lok Sabha by a prime minister who could not prove majority in the house. Now, it may thus be said that the presidential discretion is related to the political conditions. There is a greater scope for presidential assertiveness when governments are not stable and coalitions occupy power. So, the third kind of discretion that the president enjoys is in the appointment of the prime minister and the council of ministers. Start with the president's role in choosing the prime minister. This is an instance. After 1977, party politics in India became more competitive, and there have been many instances when no party had clear majority in the Lok Sabha. Now, what does the president do in such a situation? No political party or coalition secured majority in the elections held in March 1998. Now, the BJP and its allies secured 251 seats, 21 short of a majority. That means they did not get the majority in the election. Now, President Narayanan adopted an elaborate procedure. He asked the leader of the alliance, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, to furnish documents in support of his claim from concerned political parties. Not stopping at this, the president also advised Vajpayee to secure a vote of confidence within 10 days of being sworn in. So this is the discretion power that has been exercised by the President Narayanan to appoint the prime minister when no clear majority has been adopted by any of the party in the election in 1998. Now, for the most part, the president is a formal power holder and a ceremonial head of the nation. Now, you may wonder, why then do we need a president? In a parliamentary system, the Council of Ministers is dependent on the support of the majority in the legislature. This also means that the Council of Ministers may be removed at any time and a new Council of Ministers will have to be put in place. Now, in such a situation, it requires a head of the state who has fixed term. This is very important point to be noted over here about the discretionary power of the president, who may be empowered to appoint the prime minister and who may symbolically represent the entire country. This is exactly the role of the president in ordinary circumstances. Now, besides, when no party has a clear majority, the president has the additional responsibility of making a choice and appointing the prime minister to run the government of a country. So, the third discretion that is enjoyed by the president is the appointment of the prime minister and council of ministers. Now, assignment that has to be done in chapter 4, part 5 is as follows. You have to refer to the passage mentioned above and answer the following questions. This passage is already mentioned in the slide. You have to go through that. This is taken from your book, page number 86-87. You can go through that and answer the questions. What is veto power of the president? The answer would be, the veto power of the president is a power to withheld or refuse to give his assent to bills other than the money bill passed by the parliament. Number two, how a bill can be passed in a parliament and become a law? Now, answer to this would be, every bill introduced in the parliament after discussion goes to the president for his assent before it becomes a law. Though the president can send the bill back to the parliament asking it to reconsider the bill. Now, the third question is, what do you mean by pocket veto? Answer to this would be, after reconsideration, if the parliament passes the bill again and resends it to the president, then the president has to give assent to the bill. However, there is no mention in the constitution about the time limit within which the president must send the bill back for reconsideration. This means the president can just keep the bill pending with him without any time limit. This gives the president an informal power to use the veto in a very effective manner. This is sometimes referred to as pocket veto enjoyed by the president. Now, in the next session, chapter 4, part 6, executive, we will be learning about the vice president. Om Namah Shivaya.